Next, we have a panel discussion on SDN requirements in vertical markets, and we have several distinguished panelists. The moderator for the panel discussion is none other than Stephen Fuskett, who many of you know is an active participant in the world of enterprise IT. He organizes the popular Tech Field Day event series and runs Fuskett Services as well. Stephen has authored numerous articles for industry publications and is a popular presenter at industry events. It's a pleasure to present Stephen Fuskett.
I am Stephen Fuskett. Again, I am the moderator of this panel on SDN requirements in vertical markets. This is one of the things I think that a lot of folks overlook is that technology is not good for everything. Technology is good for whatever it is that you need it for. You know, it's not good for technology's sake. And one of the things that I'm particularly interested in is seeing how new technologies like SDN are going to be applied in specific markets rather than, you know, transforming the industry, how they're going to be applied, you know, across specific verticals. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Let me introduce our panelists here. I'll start with Dan Pitt, who many of you know, the executive director of the Open Networking Foundation. Dan is one of those folks, I think, that, well, I've seen him before as, at events like this, you know, very, very knowledgeable on SDN, and I welcome you here on the panel as well. We also have a group of folks from Maru who each are going to focus on a specific area of a specific vertical market for SDN. So first up, we have Avi Bhagtani, Avi, director of product management. And as we're talking, actually, the slides will be showing their bios, so I won't bother to read all of them. We also have Sarosh Visuna, vice president and general manager of business unit. Sarosh? Yep. And Manish Rai, corporate marketing. All right, Manish. So let's get things started. And I think I'd like to start with Dan, since this is, after all, SDN Connect and not Maru Wi-Fi Connect. Let's start talking about SDN. There's a lot of buzz around SDN. Certainly, it's one of those things that in the networking industry has become one of the real hot topics. And in fact, some of the people in the networking industry are already tiring of that word. Is it real? What is the promise? What is it being adopted in the, you know, how much is it being adopted in the industry? And how do we make it not just an industry buzzword, but a real thing?
Pleasure to be here. The phenomenon of SDN has, you know, been around for about 6 years, and it's taking time to get through people's minds, but I will tell you a couple of measures of where it is in adoption and deployment. There is not a single Ethernet switch vendor that does not either have OpenFlow support in it or is rapidly developing OpenFlow support in it. There is increasing evidence of quiet trials among many enterprises, and there certainly is, you know, the big news of major operators that have deployed it now for two or more years. Google is one, NTT Communications is another, Deutsche Telekom's very public trials. Croatia has now come back. They're doing it in Germany, Telefonica in Brazil, Verizon. So it's clear that everyone is working on it and thinking about it. What I think we're going to see to make it even more real is the emergence in the next 9 to 12 months of hardware switch vendors supporting OpenFlow 1.3. That's the advanced multi-table version. So far it's been 1.0, which is quite useful and has given people a lot of experience with OpenFlow and SDN. With this foundation of having, you know, OpenFlow switches and controllers available, we're now seeing investments in the software that lives above it. And you'll see that in terms of VC investments in startup companies, companies now starting to sell products, companies that are distributing software through downloads. We'll hear some today. I think in just about every measure, we can see that the industry is investing billions of dollars. And as IDC has recently shown, they're going to be reaping revenues of multiple billions of dollars in products and in services.
Yeah, it really seems like there's a pivot in the startup community from simply enabling SDN to actually doing things with SDN, to applications of SDN. Is that what you're seeing as well?
That's definitely the case. It's gotten it's like a renaissance in networking startups. We had a drought for about a dozen years after the bubble burst, because you couldn't get funding for a $150 million fabless semiconductor startup to do networking. Now it's a Web 2.0 software company that's doing it. So they're starting to meet very interesting needs in enterprise data center and carrier spaces. And we are going to, the Open Networking Foundation is sponsoring an SDN Solutions Showcase at the SDN and OpenFlow World Congress coming up next month in Dusseldorf, Germany, on the 14th to the 17th. And we have probably 30 companies that are going to be showing demos. And they're not individual company demos. Each demo has at least two vendors and one operator showing a real application. People are starting to see, gee, it really works. And it's becoming a competitive advantage for those who are deploying it early, and some of their competitors are now trying to catch up.
Yeah, that's another thing that I've noticed very much, and I think that that's sort of the nature of the technology, is that this is a cooperative endeavor. It's not a single company dominating the SDN world. It's something where we're seeing really wonderful partnerships, because that's what customers experience too. Customers generally have multiple vendors and multiple suppliers, and we're starting to see a lot of collaboration. And that's one thing that's nice about this event as well. We're going to hear from other companies that are cooperating with Maru and moving OpenFlow forward.
Yeah. It's really a rich ecosystem that is developing. And it has to be, because there are so many parts of the opportunity space for companies to invest in with a kind of a precise focus.
Yeah.
And so the operators, we have operators and vendors coming together in ONF to come up with workable, commercializable solutions to actually impact the marketplace.
Yeah. So Avi, I know that you've studied the market, since that's what you do. Tell us a little bit more about the SDN market and the growth rate, as well as the drivers for growth.
Yeah, so if you look at it from a holistic perspective, right, so we brought up some numbers in the previous slides. Numbers range from anywhere a market of $8 billion up to $15 to even $35 billion to some estimates in 2018. And the bigger factor is that the CAGRs are exponential, right? We're looking at, just from an infrastructure perspective, we see CAGR growth anywhere from 89 to 95% over the next 4 years. And then what gets even more interesting is the investment in applications, right? So what is happening, Stephen, is that a lot of companies and a lot of VCs are now funding application companies into this market, right? So if you look at purely from a CAGR perspective for applications, applications are growing at the rate of 100 to 115% of CAGR, right? So the way we see the industry grow is that we have multiple players, as Dan pointed out, right, building an ecosystem, building products and services that are going to come out venture capitalist funded, to solve the problem, not just the problems that exist in the network today, but actually create a network for the next 4 or 5 years, and not purely from a technical perspective, but actually grow the market with new products and services. You know, we have partners in here today, very innovative partners. You're going to talk to some of them. You're going to see some demos. Now, that gives you a sense of how much is being invested and how much we are trying to productize and grow the market. And it is an exponentially growing market for the next 5 to 6 years.
Do you see that the applications, like we were talking about just now with Dan, do you see the applications being the primary driver of growth, or do you think that the infrastructure has a lot of growth as well?
Well, it has to be both, right? So both the applications and the infrastructure have to grow hand in hand. What the infrastructure does is it gives you vendor-agnostic solutions, gives you the open platform to grow these applications. What the applications come in and do is build the ecosystem, right? They give you the product solutions. You talk to the folks like NEC. NEC and companies like NEC are very hardware-centric companies. And they're talking about how do you reduce the total cost of ownership of the entire network. And how you do that is basically creating open solutions, building these solutions out, and then providing the end-to-end applications that go with the hardware to go and productize and monetize this, right? So that's where the market is heading.
Yeah. I'd like to also think about some of the drivers for the growth. I think that that there certainly are a lot of current network challenges that people are facing that are causing them to go toward SDN. What about some of the other drivers? I mean, certainly there's a revolutionary aspect to it in terms of upsetting the apple cart of who's buying what from whom, you know?
So one of the biggest drivers, if you see, look at IT infrastructure per se, the big challenge has been, and it was alluded to a little while ago, is that bringing applications online is painful. Bringing any new services online is extremely difficult. Anyone who's been in the IT sector knows that if I have to write a new UCNC application, whether it's voice or video, you have to work in the paradigms of scripts, you have to work in the paradigms of what the vendors provide you, and it's a very closed ecosystem. So I would think one of the biggest drivers for the growth of SDN is going to be bringing on new services on time faster. I think that is going to be the key. It allows people to get to products faster. Mm-hmm. It allows people to solve IT solutions faster. And I think that is going to be that's where you see the growth of these applications come in, purely based on bringing new services online.
Yep.
Steve,
yep.
If I may add,
sure, yeah.
I mean, we are seeing a confluence of multiple forces here, right? Today, you had a BYOD trend that started with the iPad, right? And it's only accelerating. On top of it, now we are on the verge of Internet of Things, more and more connected devices coming into the enterprise. And when you go into enterprises today, you know, line of business is increasingly going and sourcing cloud-based applications. In marketing itself, I use half a dozen cloud-based services, and I'm bringing on right now, my director of marketing is in the process of building new services, Bezo and Demandbase, and integrating them. So what that means for IT is there is pressure on them to, there's growing expectation. They need to be aligned with business more and more, and they need to provide a self-service model to the business to bring on these apps, you know, prioritize these apps, and to onboard the devices that are coming in. In that world, the old paradigm is too slow to meet the expectations of today. They need more automation. They need more programmability. If you look at IDC's latest survey, what people want from SDN, the top responses was agility of the network, programmability of the network. It's more so than lowering the TCO. And that's what enterprises need, and that's why we are so excited and we're embracing it that we feel unlimited potential in terms of apps that can enable the next level of efficiency and productivity in the enterprise.
Mm-hmm. Stephen, I've just got a recent data point.
Okay.
I saw a demo on Tuesday from China Mobile. For customer provisioning of bandwidth and connectivity, they say they have reduced the provisioning time from 3 months to 3 minutes. And I actually saw that.
That's incredible.
And that's for their enterprise customers.
But of course, that's pretty much what this was designed to do. So that's not a surprise that they're able to do that. That's great. Actually, Dan, let's continue talking as well on standardization. That's obviously one of the main focuses for you. You know, how are we going to be standardizing these things, and how is that going to drive adoption?
So it's so interesting because ONF gets involved in standardization, but not in the old school way, where a committee goes into a smoke-filled room and comes out with the Oracle standard, and then people go build to it. We do a little bit of that for hardware implementations. But there are really three important places to standardize. And in general, the principle is if you standardize at the right place, you can foster tremendous innovation both above that interface and below it. Mm-hmm. So there are really three places where it's happening. The first place, as Ajay pointed out, is the interface between the control plane and the forwarding plane. And that's where OpenFlow is the standard. Mm-hmm. It's vendor neutral, it works, it's made for the purpose, it's an enabler. So that's taking hold throughout the industry.
Most people think that that's, you know, the extent of it, right? But there's more.
Oh, there's a lot more. So then the next place is the so-called northbound interface. Yep. That's going from the control plane to the applications. And that's where there's a lot of activity, there's no uniformity, but it's going to be implemented in software, so it'll probably end up being a de facto standard rather than a committee-defined standard. We're helping with that. We're helping to define some information models and the data models that actually you can code. But forces like OpenStack and OpenStack Neutron have made a lot of progress in saying, okay, here's my plugin interface. And the vendors write their own plugin, so it's not quite multi-vendor in the way that the OpenFlow Southbound interface is. But it's enabling people to write applications to an SDN infrastructure. And then the third place, which is a little bit of a surprise, is down in the forwarding plane itself to have more of a common interface from the OpenFlow client to the switching silicon. This has been very proprietary, and you have to have different drivers under NDA, and it's kind of slowed down the adoption of the hardware switches. Well, we're seeing some coming together of the industry players to define some common ways of approaching their the SDK APIs to their hardware abstraction layer of their chipsets without revealing their proprietary nature. So we're actually working to help foster that through some ways of generically programming pipelines and switches. And I think that that third interface, which has been a sleeper for a couple of years, will also become an important one.
Great. Now, I want to encourage Sarosh and Manish to jump in here. I don't want to make it sound like I'm only asking Avi things, but I am. Avi, one of the things that we've noticed at Tech Field Day, we do wireless field day and networking field day, there's basically a collision between wired and wireless right now. And it's a real problem for a lot of companies because they've traditionally had those things be two totally different worlds. Is SDN going to be able to help make that work better? Is it going to be able to integrate and allow such heterogeneous networks?
Yeah, so for that, you need to have an SDN field day now since you have a wireless field day and a tech field day.
Yeah, we'll get started on that.
But yeah, so if you look at the natural progression of SDN, right, it started where we'd expected. It came down from data centers. We had the big players, the Googles of the world, start implementing open standards, open networks, right? Facebook very recently announced its entry into the OCP. And then you saw service provider markets now look at open standards as well through L4, through L27 protocols, and a lot of the China carriers are starting to do that as well. And then it came to enterprises, right?
So when you look
at enterprises now, enterprises were purely looked at from the perspective of wired enterprise. And therein where the first innovations of OpenFlow and open standards started. But as you go through the enterprise, you start to realize, and this was, again, alluded a while ago, is that the edge is changing. The enterprise edge is changing. Wireless is becoming a predominant entry point for devices into the network. And when
in
that
some
happens,
cases, even the only entry point.
The only, yeah. Right? I mean, you know, I don't know how many people are connected to the wired in here, but I would seriously doubt that there's anyone here plugged into a wired network, right? Yeah. And so effectively what that did was, when we started looking at it, we started realizing the network challenges, even though they originate on the wired interface, the overlay is wireless. So the natural progression was to basically create a unified network, the concept of a unified network, and try to solve the network challenges today. Now, when we look at that, OpenFlow kind of became the de facto standard. And when we could put OpenFlow on a wireless LAN controller like we did, it basically gave you that single point of control using an open standard to build on. When we look at some of the solutions like Microsoft Link, we're partnering with Link and with Microsoft to basically give us the unified communication experience across wired and wireless. Mm-hmm. Now, don't get us wrong, there are other folks who are already doing it, right? These applications do exist there out today. But the challenge is these applications are very vendor specific. They lock you into certain calls, certain of their own internal interfaces, and you're basically restricted by the policies and the control these applications give you. But you as an IT administrator want to step back. You want to say, I want to have more control of my network. Like Dan said, these APIs, these standardizations now start to apply across unified networks. And once you start applying them over unified networks, you get two big things. One is a holistic view of the network. So you can, and you will see this in some of our demos today, when you go use an Open Daylight or some other open standard controller, you can actually see the network end-to-end. And when you see the network end-to-end, you can apply policies to the network end-to-end, you can control the network end-to-end, and you can debug and troubleshoot the network end-to-end. And the key thing there is it gives you the maximum user experience that is controlled from one end of the device to the other end of the spectrum holistically.
So if I may add...
Oh, of course, yes, please do. Yeah.
Quickly. That for years we've had one large company that had a major share of the networking market and in the wired side, right? And their pitch has been to enterprise that hey, you are better off going to one-stop shop that can provide you everything end-to-end, from switches, access points, to all the security and voice and all the solutions you need. But I see parallels in that model to the carrier world, right? When the carriers were closed, the pace of innovation was slow, the apps were not that good, and they were expensive. What iPhone did when it came out, it changed the game. It opened it up, the network, and then you saw the innovation that got unleashed in the last few years. I think SDN changes the game and tilts the balance in favor of best of breed. I mean, Meru has staking its claim on providing best of breed Wi-Fi, and we feel you can more easily mix and match solutions now. And the innovation needs to be in applications. And we're going to invest in applications and bring to you applications that work across wired and wireless. And I think it's a great thing for the industry, and it's a very exciting time.
Yeah, that's a really nice parallel, actually, because you're right. I mean, it created a whole new industry. And the industry is not in, you know, nuts and bolts, hardware and infrastructure. The industry is in applications. It's in enabling people to do new and interesting things with this technology.
Right.
And that's actually the next thing that I want to talk about. I want to talk about some of the vertical applications of SDN and Wi-Fi. I also want to point out as well that I believe that we've got a microphone down here. If you guys have any questions or comments while we're going, or if anybody else in the room does, not limited to just my invitees, of course, please do raise your hand. Tom will be happy to hand you the microphone, and we would love to entertain that here up on stage. But let's start with vertical markets. One area that I'm very familiar with from Wireless Field Day, because we have folks who specialize in this vertical market, hello Lee, is education. There's a lot, it's such an interesting vertical because as a wise man said, you have a whole wave of tens of thousands of new users every, September. And then they all vanish once again, and a whole different group comes along. Also, because they're such demanding, it's such a demanding environment because these people have grown up in the application-centric world that you just mentioned. And it's not enough to give people a wired connection. When I went to college, we didn't have wired connections, let alone Wi-Fi. I guess I'm old. talk about the particulars of that education market.
So you hit the nail on the head, right, Stephen? Education, and it's not just higher ed, right? I mean, initially there was a lot of devices proliferation in the higher ed market. Now mm-hmm. you're starting to see that even in through K through 12. And what is happening is it's the market for education is becoming very, very centric, device-centric market. People are bringing their own devices. This BYOD explosion we keep talking about, or BYOA, or mm-hmm. what have you, is actually being strongly driven by the growth of this education market sector and the transition of that into pure IT-based services, right? So if you start looking at the purely at the education market, you start seeing devices that are coming in. Every new device is coming online every day, and these devices have to be managed. And for a while, again, this was the way that the networks were being done, was wireless was being managed purely from solutions that didn't give you the full end-to-end control. Look at some examples, right? So we have an application here that we're going to demo for Bonjour. A Bonjour as a service is when you bring a device online, you basically create a whole flood of traffic and a whole flood of traffic on your network domain. And what we can do with applications that we have developed is you can now start controlling your broadcast domain. If you're a teacher in a classroom, you can decide who gets access to what network device. You basically start attaching services to devices using wired or wireless. You can have a printer connected to your wired device, and you can say, student A, now you have access to this printer on the wired device. And using the same policies, now you can say, student B, you actually have access to project your iPad onto the screen using Bonjour services. So now, as a teacher, you start getting control, right? Now, as we started going through universities, right, and we're spending a lot of time with universities. We actually have at least one or two POCs running actively that we are experimenting with. And what we start to see is you go across the gamut and you start seeing solutions. Traffic prioritization. Let's say there is a new class comes online. and you want to dynamically move traffic patterns to that classroom. Sports events going on, events where streaming happens and you want to now start controlling the network bandwidth from an end-to-end perspective in those universities, right? So what is starting to happen is you now have control from an end-to-end perspective to bring these services and to dynamically prioritize and control traffic in these environments, which before, for an IT administrator, it was pretty much had to go out there and do it sort of one node at a time. And now you can basically do it from a holistic perspective, mm-hmm. right? So use cases, you'll see a lot of use cases. There's a lot of discussions going on, emergency management systems, you know, traffic bandwidth prioritizations, NAC solutions, right? Today, when you do NAC solutions, again, they're very centric to whether you're on the wired network or the wireless network. We are actually working with a couple of partners who are very strong NAC partners, open source NAC partners, and pretty much, to Dan's point, they actually had a solution, a NAC solution based on OpenFlow and a wired switch. In a matter of 24 hours, they actually used our controller and make that same solution work on a wireless network. And now you have a NAC solution that is wired and wireless unified. So these are the kind of services that you get when you look purely from an education perspective, right, and the growth of these devices in them.
Now, one thing I think that's hitting education people today is that Apple just released a new version of iOS. I know that that's hitting no matter which area you're in. I've seen some amazing charts. That was such a big driver of traffic. Is there something that can be done about that using this technology?
Yeah, so do you want to comment on that? So that's obviously a very relevant problem that we have right now. So one of the things that we are looking at is, through a POC in one of the universities, is basically to start throttling iOS in a way that you can have controlled bandwidth distribution of mm-hmm. iOS across these networks, right? Now, this is a big problem. It's not easily solvable because ultimately the network bandwidth limits it, right? We are limited by the network bandwidth on what we do. But what we can do is we can control and police the download of these iOS services or the actual OS to some extent that can actually protect your network from that. We don't have a whole solution yet.
Yeah. And of course, the same technology could be used for other crush events, you know, World Cup, mm-hmm. Super Bowl, those kind of events as well. So let's pivot for a minute into the healthcare industry as well. Another thing that we see a lot at Wireless Field Day, many of our Wireless Field Day delegates specialize in healthcare wireless, specifically hospitals and making sure that that the base connectivity is there. But of course, that's all evolving as well, just like education. So maybe, Sarosh, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So, you know, the healthcare field, I mean, we talked a lot about the technology, what it can do. But it's not going to be successful unless someone makes money out of it. And healthcare is going to be one of those major industries that is really dying for this. So what's healthcare about? It's about services. Mm-hmm. And what's the promise of SDN? It's to deliver efficient services and orchestrate those services. The second thing that's happening in healthcare really is innovation. There's a lot of different things going on that are going to be network controlled, remotely controlled. And today, many of those things are developed separately. Each company develops their own systems. Let's look at what's legacy in healthcare. It started with electronic records, right? So there were all the electronic records first. They were very much static. People used a laptop, entered the records. Then they used a little cart and carried that cart along to the patient bedside and entered the records. But that's still very static type applications. With that came voice over IP. All of a sudden in healthcare you had voice over IP, yet voice over IP used very little bandwidth, had no connection to the people who did the electronic medical records and was completely a disparate system. The third thing that started becoming a little bit important was real-time location systems, sort of RFID, but more real-time location systems on Wi-Fi, again developed by separate companies. There was no connection between a nurse administering something to a patient by bedside where the location is logged, the nurse making that call from the bedside to the physician, and the fact that they're entering some electronic medical records at that bedside. There was just no coordination. There was no sense of, that there was anything common among those things. Yet, from a services standpoint, the innovation had to be that there's a commonality, there's a service, and it's all tied together. So I think the second thing that will happen is It'll really accelerate innovation in that space. Let me describe one area in healthcare that's beginning to evolve pretty fast. This is voice over IP takes very little bandwidth. Electronic medical records take very little bandwidth. And real-time location systems also don't take bandwidth. But what's coming is the unified communication of video and voice. One example of that application in healthcare is effectively language translation. You know, patients come into the hospitals, clinics, long-term care facilities speaking different languages. They don't all speak English. Traditionally, you had a live person trying to come in there, do the translation. Guess what? Unless you know in advance that the person does not speak the physician's language, it's when the nurse walks the patient in, then calls up someone, and time is wasted. So there are services that have started which provide you similar online translation. A little device is rolled into the room, a laptop with a screen. The patient just kind of taps on the screen, or the physician taps on the screen with the language of the patient. Up comes a live person from somewhere in the world, there may be anywhere in the world, and this person now talks to the patient and the physician. Let's say the physician's talking in English, the patient's talking in Spanish, and this is the language translator. So what does that do? All of a sudden, your network has to be scaled. The hospital network suddenly needs this whole multimedia live service to work. It has to scale, which means the policies that have to be applied over the basically the northbound application area have to work across the different applications, which is voice, video, and some of the other real-time location systems. The capacity of the network has to go up. And again, these sort of services are pay-as-you-go subscription services. These are actually time-bound services, and the more time you waste trying to get the network to work, trying to get the picture to be good, the more you pay, or the more time you waste of the physician and the patient. So this is where, really, if you think of the promise of SDN, to be able to roll out new applications in a speedy manner, mm-hmm. to foster innovation and to enable these pay-as-you-go services mm-hmm. will become important.
Yeah. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. I think they had me just mix you up, so there you go.
The micro.
Yeah.
There we go. So I've got a quick question on, because I deal with a lot of larger hospital chains mm-hmm. And things like that, and you look at all the different products they have in there from Cerner to Epic and all the storage backend stuff. Yep. And you know, one of the things that comes to mind is how risk averse they have to be by nature, right? I mean, they'll yes. put a product in when it's rock solid, but they cannot have, you know, some of this stuff have even the slightest hiccup. Where do you think we are with SDN as regards some of those large hospital chains? When would you feel comfortable, or when do you think we'll be comfortable advocating
That they would implement SDN, right?
Right.
So I think what I see is this is kind of an evolution in the hospitals. As you just said, many of these systems initially were wired because they did not believe anything in wireless could work, right? Then they went to WMTS, just dedicated wireless medical telemetry systems. They never believed that anything could work on Wi-Fi, and now it's on Wi-Fi. I think the next step, and when, I think it's in the next 3 to 5 years. Hospitals are conservative. There'll be some at the leading edge in the next 1 to 2 years, and the rest of them will come after the first few big systems try it out. There are several chains that are at the leading edge of innovation that will try it out in smaller hospitals, but I think it'll happen in first mm-hmm. these next 2 years, and then 2 to 5 years is when the real volume of the business will be.
Yeah, and actually I think that there is a compelling factor as well for hospitals, especially because there's a security aspect.
Yes.
To this as well. I mean, you can, it's not just about enabling services, it's also about disabling services. And I think yes. that's a great way to keep you from getting fired.
I can take a few seconds and walk you through the life of a medication in a hospital and how that is audited, right? The medication comes in from the vendor. Some of it has to be cold storage and put into some cold storage. You have to create an audit record of when it went into cold storage, how long it stayed there, what temperature it was at. And traditionally, they have had nurses or other people go to these cold storage, actually look at a thermometer in the cold storage, write down the temperature, and basically keep a log, which is not really auditable. Mm-hmm. So now they've been doing it with real-time location systems. But then that medication comes out, they have to track it and be able to tell how long it's been out of that freezer, when was it administered, where was it administered, or whether the patient and the medication and the nurse were at the same place when it was administered, which proves that the right patient got the right medication and the nurse who's responsible gave it.
Yeah, and that's so actually even that's more important policy. Than keeping from getting fired.
Right, so yeah. That's a whole, now, you know what? Each of these applications can be, are today separately developed, the location system application, the logging, the temperature, but with SDN, the policies can be applied to the SDN controller, and essentially each of those application writers don't have to have their own algorithm to track this.
So let's turn to another important vertical for Wi-Fi. We discussed this at our last wireless field day as well. The key question is not, you know, should hotels and hospitality offer Wi-Fi? The question is Wi-Fi a utility that people should demand, like water or electricity or elevators or something? You know, it's become absolutely critical. In fact, I got to tell you, if I went to a hotel and there was no Wi-Fi, I would walk out the door. And so that's just how it is. So, you know, I know that, Manish, you have some experience in this area. Do you want to talk a little bit about SDN in hospitality?
Absolutely. We were recently at a high-tech show, and we thought hospitality maybe not a great market for SDN, but after we met a few of the prospects and customers, it was really a mind-changing experience for us. We saw such a good excitement amongst those prospects and customers out there about SDN, because what's happening in hospitality is this competition for attracting that customer, right? It's all about delighting the customer and his experience. In the past, hotels didn't pay any attention to spending $100,000 to put a beautiful palm tree, mm-hmm. but wouldn't spend on Wi-Fi. Till recently, when they started seeing Wi-Fi as the top desired amenity ahead of the quality of the bed, right? Mm-hmm. So now they're putting in Wi-Fi, and now when you go to a hotel room, it's like a mini conference room. You have a family with two kids, everyone with 3-4 devices. They want it to work. They're streaming Netflix rather than watching cable, and they want to be able to project it to TV out there in the hotel room. And all these things, there are cool application ideas, but the network becomes the bottleneck. Our customers are telling us, we can build cool applications, but provisioning it through the network is too difficult, and that's what excites them. That if I can provision it, and if a platinum customer comes in through the door, immediately I can enable through the app access to his room, ability for him to, in a contained manner, project to the TV, and nobody else can project to the TV. And then when he makes a call from his iPhone, to room service, we can prioritize that call over not only other traffic, but also other customers' traffic who are not platinum, right?
As somebody who stays in too many hotels,
right, exactly.
I would like to endorse this concept.
So that's the vision. And think about how delighted will you be if you go and it sets up the room temperature to your liking, and it's provision that you can, with a flick of your hand, now project from your iPad onto the TV, and you're getting that premium service. When you walk into the restaurant, there's a locationing based on iBeacon on your iPhone, and the alert goes out to the waiter that you have a platinum guest walking in, and he greets you by name.
It's right? Like he's talking just to me. I don't know.
And that's the potential. Yeah. I think the excitement is they want to roll out applications faster because there's more competition, and they are slowed down by the network. So we are seeing a lot of excitement in this vertical.
I'd like to add a little bit to this. So these three markets that you've looked at, the education, healthcare, hospitality, there's a commonality behind them, which is they're all in the services industry. If you look at it, each of this is a services industry where the people using the services are continuously mobile, usually unpredictable of when and where they'll show up, or they keep showing up in different places, unlike an office where people just go in and sit in their offices. And the third thing is the capacity needs for these three markets are increasing by leaps and bounds. They're somewhat unpredictable. And that's where being able to use SDN to make this more predictable, to make rolling out the capacity much more efficient is going to be important.
Let me just make a little technical point, Stephen. When we talk about open flow, and what does this mean? We're abstracting the network. We're making it really flow-based, policy-driven network, where you can define a flow technically based on really anything that goes through a switch. And that can include the application identifier, the user identifier, and you can treat that flow in a particular way to meet some kind of revenue objective, security objective, policy objective, compliance objective. So it's just degrees of freedom you never had before.
I saw a question over here, Alex.
So one of the things we talked about in the hospitality industry, and one of the kind of thing that's been firing up in the security industry is PayPal tries to do exactly that with mobile payments. Know exactly where everyone is, what their preferences, et cetera. And I realize this isn't necessarily the area of focus, but how do we blend privacy and personal privacy with access to the network?
So I think that's an age-old debate, right? Whenever there's always sort of a balance between innovation and rolling out new services and security, and there's always a tension, right? So some companies say, hey, we cannot afford not to innovate. We want to capture more eyeballs. We want to push the boundaries, and they are the leading adopters. They're going to adopt technology. They're going to take the risk. Sometimes new applications have lower risk because people haven't figured out there are not enough people trained on that technology to be able to hack into it. But and at the other spectrum, you have risk-averse organizations, you know, who don't lead the adoption, right, and who are going to wait for the technology to mature. But I think with OpenFlow, actually, we can strengthen the security even more, right? When you have visibility to those flows, and you can detect much easier across the entire network denial of service attacks or people trying to do something that is unusual. It's becoming much easier to detect end-to-end across the network, and it'll become harder for people as a result to hack into it. So there'll be, I think, they're both sides of it. It opens up, and potentially the programmability opens it up to more hacking, but also at the same time, it gives you more tools to get visibility into what's going on in the network and mm-hmm. prevent those kind of attacks.
Yeah, I think a lot of exploits come from integration points between non-integrated systems. Mm-hmm. And absolutely. So, you know, that's a good point, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think, just if I can add to that, I think that's a very relevant question. And by the way, we hear that across the board, right? This is a good debate we had last week while we were in Barcelona, too. Some of our partners were asking this exact same question, right? When you talk about locationing and privacy, where is the divide, right? How do you make sure that you're not, you know, you can, as an organization, you can continue to do your, you can get the data you need in terms of driving your SLAs, in terms of driving your market presence versus protecting the privacy, right? So there's things that are happening. For instance, right, when we talk about IoT, and we've been focused a lot on it, as well as other companies have, if you look at Bluetooth, for instance, right, Bluetooth is a classic example where you can do presence analytics without getting into all the details of forcing folks to go log into anything, right? So the idea is that there is two variations of this. One, which is presence analytics, right, where you can actually find out who's been where, for how long, and how they migrate through either a hotel or a hospitality industry. And the other piece is the actual market analysis and the market presence where you do couponing. That's where you actually go opt into a system and say, okay, now I can go and push what I need to push to the system.
Yeah, and I think that opt-in is a very, very important mm-hmm. point. Right. We discussed this at a previous Wireless Field Day roundtable. A lot of people are very concerned about the implications of social Wi-Fi in particular. And I think that if the industry adopted a strong stance toward opt-in, mm-hmm. it would really help alleviate that concern. Because as, you know, I'm still dreaming of that hotel. I would opt into that.
yep.
You know, but I don't want to opt into just somebody snooping on me when I just casually am walking down the street. You know, it's a very, very different experience. So did we have another question down here? Okay. Go ahead. Thank you very much for pointing that out.
Hi, my name is Kashyap, and I have a question more for like Avi and Dan. Like, where do we expect the market to be with respect to SDN in a year from now and 5 years from now?
A year from now, the market, where do you expect the market to be?
Booming. The market. Boy.
Yeah, I would be shocked if you Maru guys said, "Oh, this thing's going to tank."
No. We don't do market studies, so I look what DeLauro says, I look what IDC says, and what Wiretap mm-hmm. Ventures and SDN Central say. And so, The market for infrastructure equipment is clearly growing, and they've got some targets for that. Market for applications is growing. It's a little bit harder to measure. But this is like a hand-in-glove thing. You need the infrastructure to make it worth investing in applications. And without applications, there's no point in having the infrastructure. So I think they're working in lockstep, both growing significantly. I think IDC is the most recent numbers, and they're quite exciting.
I think, you know, 1 year may be a short period, but between now and about the next 2 years, just look at the players in the infrastructure side of it. Those players will have a vested interest in investing in new startups in SDN applications, in inciting these applications. So like you said, it's a hand in glove, but you want someone to use that new infrastructure and it'll just happen. This is the same question people asked when voice over IP first happened and said, who cares about voice over IP? You have voice over cell phone and voice over landlines. And it just depends on the players driving it.
We're going to see, you know, more trials, and I hope we're going to get more publicity of actual deployments. I know of one particular infrastructure vendor that has told me, I have between 200 and 300 enterprise customers, but I can't tell you their names because it's secret right now. I think these will come out. I mean, they're doing small-scale trials. They don't want to necessarily give away what they're doing. For many of them, it's a competitive advantage. But I think over time it will become much more publicly known.
So if I may cite some numbers from the recent IDC release, I think where you see wide fluctuations in numbers is on the infrastructure side, because there's so many people adding OpenFlow support. Do you count all the equipment with OpenFlow support? That can become a huge number if you count
that. Pretty soon, I think it's going to be all of it.
Everybody. So that's a massive number if you look at that. But more interesting to me was the applications number, where IDC projected about $1.6 billion in application market by 2018. So that's growing at more than 100% annually. That's the exciting part. Looking at SDN services, about a $2 billion market, again, growing at 100% plus annually. So those two numbers sounded pretty exciting to me when you look at the market potential.
And by the way, I think IDC's numbers for infrastructure ports were not just, you know, capable ports that are out there, but ports that are actually turned on and used for OpenFlow and SDN.
Right.
And I think the real telling factor is going to be the, you know, the proof is going to come from end user demand. You know, essentially, if people have applications that need this, then they're going to drive it. We're going to hear about Link. Link is really rapidly spreading in enterprise IT, and it is not great without this, you know, without what you guys are going to talk. I don't want to steal your steal your thunder, but I think I know where you're going. You know, I think that this is a really, really good use case, and it's going to be a driver, and I think people will be looking for a solution to specific problems like that, and that's what's going to drive it forward. So we do have just a few more minutes. I wanted to see if we had any more questions out there before I ask my big question.
Questions?
Oh, here, yeah.
Hi, this is, I'm Lakshmi, Director of Engineering, SDN and Applications. This question is to Dan. Dan, I see a lot of traction around like a market education group or migration working group, which are started in ONF, but they are majorly focused on service provider market. But where do you see, I mean, when do you see like those groups focusing on enterprises?
So, I think the rollout has been data centers first, carriers second, and enterprises third, except in the financial services sector. That's a leading enterprise use case, and they're very active and present on our board. So enterprises are really looking at two avenues of adopting SDN. One is to do it themselves. The other is to get it from some kind of a service provider for more of their global network. They are being tempted by public cloud services, either by the independent cloud vendors or the telecom service providers, and also people who want to sell them technology for in-house, premises-based cloud, private cloud networks based on SDN management. So enterprises, to me, is a very, very broad term. You've got sectors that are really aggressive and sectors that are very conservative. But they are kind of the last domino to fall. And those are the large ones. The small ones, the small and medium enterprises, some of them are moving very quickly because they see a solution, it meets a particular need, and they can act quickly on it. There's an important role for resellers and system integrators in that market, and so we work with a number of those also to try to get them to add the customization and then the software and some of the glue that make it very easy for their small and medium enterprise customers to adopt some particular solution for a particular need. I hope that answers your question.
Sure.
Now, we are running out of time. I have one more thing that I want to bring up, and that is this is new technology. This is exciting technology. People want to know more. People want to be educated in this. I wonder if, does anyone have any suggestions on where people can go if they've seen this and they've said, wow, you know, I'm a hotel guy. I really want to do that thing so Stephen will come to my hotel. Where can they learn more about this stuff? Dan, you want to start?
Well, there are lots of places where they can learn about it. We have a lot of information on our website at opennetworking.org. Some of it is very technical, but we also talk about use cases, solution briefs, kind of a high level. And I tell companies that say, you know, where do I go from here? I say, well, read what you can online here. There are really two really important conferences. One is the Open Networking Summit, put on by sort of the Stanford crew. It's going to be next June. Usually it's in March, but it'll be June next year. And then the other one in Europe in October, that's the SDN and OpenFlow World Congress, a great place to learn. And you can actually go online and see all of the presentations of the past 3 years for these shows. So that's very helpful. And then I say go ask your vendors, but listen with a skeptical ear to see how open their definition of open is. You know, there are multiple sources. The hard part for someone wanting to learn is knowing what to believe. So we try to be the sort of the vendor-neutral truth teller of what SDN really is for the benefit of those who operate networks. There are many more credible sources coming online right now, and there are also some training courses in the technology and in skills that we're helping. And then there are actually MOOCs, the massive open online courses that universities offer, and you can just go watch some of those lectures, and they will get you up to speed very quickly, but it takes some pretty deep concentration.
And as a marketing guy, I have to make a plug for Meru. So, by the way, we have merunetworks.com/SDN, and we have a nice webinar recording from Ajay over there, SDN Demystified, and there'll be more and content showing up over there, so we encourage you to visit that. But I visit that, as well as SDN Central is a great site, which regularly visit to stay up to date on the latest news.
And with that, I'm going to close it down. But I actually want to make a plug for one more place you can look. That would be Tech Field Day, of course. techfieldday.com. And actually, the easiest way to find, you know, to find our content is just to use the Googles, yes, or the Bings or the DuckDuckGoes or whoever it is that you prefer. Essentially, there are a great many wonderful videos, deep technical discussions with some of our favorite technical people in the industry talking about, I see another one back there talking about SDN. So just, you know, look for Tech Field Day or Networking Field Day, SDN, SDN Wi-Fi, you know, your favorite vendor, you know, you can plug in Meru if you want, and I'm sure that you'll find some great content there as well.